Well, here we are, week three edition of the Green Zone Blitz, the podcast here in the PlayNow.com studio. Jamie Nye, Britton Gray, getting you set for week three against the Calgary Stampeders. But as always, we have to look back at week number two. As I called it, the greatest 18-point loss in Saskatchewan Roughriders history, according to our listeners. There's a lot of optimism after the loss to Winnipeg. And that's because the offense looked good more than anything, Britton. I think when the offense has 400 yards passing by Trevor Harris, you can sell that to the fans. But they lost by 18 to the Winnipeg Blue Bombers last year, and it was a completely different feeling because they had no offensive production whatsoever. So what a difference a year makes in 18-point losses to the Winnipeg Blue Bombers.
I mean, no doubt. Like, I get it. There's positives to take away, but that's, I think, just because Rider fans are just tired of the Bombers dominating the series so often that they're looking for any sort of positives. Still an 18-point loss, and I think we need to start having a conversation about that Bombers defense, because they are giving up a lot of points to opposing offenses this season early. Mm-hmm. And so I still view it as an 18-point loss. That it, like, yeah, it looked better on paper, but you still don't feel close to beating the Bombers. And we'll get to it a little bit later, but as we saw, the Bombers might not be the best team in the West Division anymore.
Well, that's just it. Like, does the game against the BC Lions change your opinion on, should we be that optimistic that they lost by 18 to the Winnipeg Blue Bombers? Because I'm sorry, when the power rankings come out next week, when I do them up, I think the BC Lions are going to be number one now in the Canadian Football League, no matter what Toronto does against the Edmonton Elks.
It wasn't just that the BC Lions beat the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. They completely dismantled them at IG Field after all this talk about the Bombers offense being so good and being the strength of that team. I don't know how deep you want to go into it right now, but that Bombers team looked old last night.
Mm-hmm. They did. They absolutely did. But going back to the Rider Bomber game, it kind of fell apart for the Riders. There was that challenge that happened with Mike O'Shea on the Janarian Grant punt return. Now, I will say that should have been a punt return touchdown. There shouldn't have been a flag. They got the call right. I didn't like how long it took to allow Mike O'Shea to decide to challenge that call on the punt return and the illegal block to the back, but it happened. And once again, like we heard last year, we have Craig Dickinson after the game saying that's their conditioning and we need to be in better shape. And the fans are tired of that. Like, what are you saying? Everybody else isn't. Why then? Why? Why is everybody else in the Canadian Football League in shape, and the Saskatchewan Roughriders aren't out of the gate for the second straight year? Like, that's what's frustrating, is to hear that again from Coach Craig Dickinson for the second. Oh, we just got to get in better shape. You just got to finish better and execute better, because the Bombers did it. They're 5-for-5 in the red zone, executing touchdowns every time they got inside the 20-yard line. That defense needs to be better.
And I've covered this team the entirety of the Craig Dickinson era, and every year it seems like conditioning is an issue. And it's like, what do you mean conditioning's an issue? Every team gets the same amount of time to prepare. Why is it that the Riders can't seem to play a full four quarters? What are you doing in your training that it's just, apparently conditioning is a major issue in Saskatchewan? That to me, that's not an excuse. These are pro football players. They get paid to play all four quarters. And if conditioning is an issue already, it's inexcusable. You can't just find your conditioning by week 9 and assume you're going to put together a great season. You need to be ready to go from the get-go, especially in what we expect to be a very tight West Division. Even the Elks haven't looked good, but they might turn a corner at any point, and if that happens, this division could be way up in the air, especially with what we saw what BC just did.
Yeah, and I the strength and conditioning coach, Clint Spencer, he's one of the best in the Canadian Football League, and he runs them through it. So to have strength and conditioning be an excuse, I think, is unfair to Coach Spencer, because I know the program he runs them through. He has them ready to go. So But the one other thing with Coach Dickinson is the decision making. Like at some point, you can't have a coach kick a field goal down by 14 late in the game when all the analytics tell you it's probably going to be two or three possessions you got left in a two possession game, and you're going to keep it a two possession game. Like you need that touchdown to make it a one possession game right then and there. And he talked about after the game, yeah, I probably should have done it. Well, to go up against Rick Campbell and Mike O'Shea and Dave Dickinson and Chris Jones, who are all veteran head coaches, Craig Dickinson needs to make the right decision then and there in the fourth quarter and not after the game go, yeah, I probably should have gone for it. Like, and this has been a thing with Craig his entire time.
Yeah, I mean, it's year four. Like, you can't be making these kind of rookie head coaching mistakes anymore. You've been in the league for a while. Situationally, you have to be better, because when you do get to the playoffs, when you do get late in the season, these head coaches will make you pay for any sort of mistake, any sort of extra possession you give them. So I just don't know if you're going to fix it. Like I said, it's year four. Maybe this is just kind of a Craig Dickinson team. Sometimes a coaching decision might not be the best, and it's up to the team to kind of get them out of the hole that they're put in, which is just tough sailing against these veteran coaches. Like you said, going against his brother, what the stats book came out, he's 1-6 against Dave. Like, you need to do better.
I will defend him. He's actually 6-2 against Dave because he did win a playoff game. So fair. He's 6-1 in the regular season, but he did beat Dave in a playoff game.
1-6.
There it is. He's got two wins.
Yeah.
Against his brother, one in the playoffs, one in the regular season. I did want to point that out because I saw the stat and I'm like, well, I think the playoff win counts.
It does. It should.
Yeah, absolutely. So he's got that one. But you know, you look around the coaching in the Canadian Football League, and you have veterans in Orlando Steinauer. Jason Moss has coached a long time as well. I know Bob Dice is new, but that West Division coaching, you got to be making those sound strategic decisions. And everybody will say, oh, it's easy for you guys sitting up in the press box who have all day to think about these things. Yeah, it is easy for us, but it's hard to be a head coach in the Canadian Football League. But great head coaches don't go, yeah, I probably should have done that half an hour after the decision was made. They know what to do in every situation, and they right then and there when they have to make the call. So outside of that, a 400-yard passing game. Hello, Trevor Harris. There he is, what everybody was hoping to see from the passing attack for the Saskatchewan Roughriders. Sam Emilis goes off, the guy you've been selling us on, Britton Gray, since yep. training camp as well. Tevin Jones got over 100 yards. Sean Bain had a good game as well.
I mean, 400 yards is a good accomplishment, something we know Trevor Harris can do. He's done it multiple times in his career. But I don't look at that game as necessarily being an effective 400-yard passing day, just because they didn't go over 30 points, which I think you should do when you have 400 yards passing. And it was more of a necessity. They had to keep pace with the Bombers for that entire game, and the running game was non-existent for the Riders the entire game. I think Jamal Morrow had 6 rushes the entire game. Frankie Hickson had 1 before he got hurt. Shea Patterson had 3, and Trevor Harris had 1 or 2, and that was your running attack. And there was not a lot of rushes, especially by running backs. So it was more of a necessity. You sometimes see that with quarterbacks. We see it all the time when you're playing fantasy football. You want quarterbacks who are down tend to throw for a lot of yards because that is just what they have to do to stay in the game. So that's what I felt that game went to. But take nothing away from what we saw in that. Like, no one expected that offense to be clicking that this early in the season, missing Darrell Walker, Tevin Jones having to come in, who didn't have a full training camp because he was dealing with an injury. And then, like you said, Sam Emilis kind of came to fruition after all we've been hearing through training camp, after watching training camp. He dropped a touchdown in Edmonton, so he bounced back in a big way. Now, can you do it 2-3 weeks in a row? That's the thing we haven't seen from this Riders offense yet, because it's early. We've only had 2 games, so can't put together a 3-game stretch in 2 games. Impossible. But now you need to start putting together good performances, start seeing Trevor Harris throw for near 300 yards in back-to-back-to-back games. And then you have a little bit more confidence because, like I said earlier, there needs to be a conversation about this Bombers defense. We have to start talking about it because this is, doesn't feel like the same dominant defense we've seen or expected early in this season.
No, they have not. We'll go around the CFL a little later, but when you look at the Saskatchewan Roughriders and the other carryover from that game against the Winnipeg Blue Bombers, I'm just going to look at the depth chart here. 10 changes for the Riders roster going into the game Saturday against the Calgary Stampeders, and some of these are going to be significant injuries. So Jaden Dahlke, Joan Breskinson, Nick Daly, all Canadians, all on the 6-game injured list, already joining Canadians, Kian Schaefer-Breaker, Godfrey Onyeka, Braden Lenius, and Philip Blake on the 6-game injured list. Also, Albert Awachi goes on the 1-game. Frankie Hickson, Jeremy Clark, DeMarcus Christmas, Rodney Clemens. These are a lot of injuries and a lot. I think this is almost 25% of the roster changing over this week against the Calgary Stampeders, and it's going to be interesting how they mix things up. Let's just start with the defense. There's two good news stories. Is Nick Marshall and Derek Moncrief are back. Moncrief's first start of the season, missed all of training camp because of that shoulder injury, so it's good to have Derek Moncrief back. But Nelson Lacombo will get the start at safety. Henderson's moved to halfback. Williams goes to the other corner after doing a pretty darn good job. He was one of the top-rated defensive backs in his first ever start in the Canadian Football League, filling in for Nick Marshall last week. But you're going to have to put Charbel DeBeer as a starter and Micah Johnson as the designated nationalized American. So we'll see how the Riders juggle their defensive line this week against Calgary.
Yeah, it should be interesting. I mean, injuries kind of just happen. Like I've said, this feels just like bad luck. I don't know. You can't plan for injuries, really. So we'll see. Jaden Dahlke's a big loss. He looked like his star was just rising fast in the CFL, and he could be that next great Canadian defender. But we'll see. Nelson Lacombo, second overall pick a few years ago. They've had high hopes for him. Hasn't lived up to that. He had that unfortunate pass interference penalty against the Bombers where you can question whether or not it was. That was the play we all thought Craig should have at least challenged to get a look at it that late.
I'm going to cut you off. He shouldn't have challenged it. Now, I looked it back and I saw it and I'm like, no, the contact was clearly made before the tip happened. I'm like, okay, he saw that. I'm going to go backsies on that because I criticized him on the pass. I thought it was, okay, he saw it and went, yeah. Lacombo ran into the receiver well before the ball was tipped.
Okay, so great coaching decision, Craig. You did it. But I'm excited to see Nelson Lacombo. This really feels like a proven year for him if the Riders want to keep him around or not after this season. He's been around long enough where you kind of need to start seeing that pick come to fruition a little bit. Otherwise, is he just kind of a backup special teamer? That's not what they wanted him to be. They expected him to come in and be a great defender. So I'm excited to see him. Like you said, we'll see how Micah Johnson fits into all this, how many plays he's in there for Charbel DeBeer. But hey, DeBeer had a sack last week. Or 2 weeks ago. He has a sack on the season. But he is turning into a good Canadian for them along that defensive line. And Nick Marshall's back. And like I said, Derek Moncrief being back, I think, is big. He was their only All-Star last season, a West Division All-Star, the only one that the voters thought had really a good year, an All-Star season, sorry, from the Riders. So he's excited to be back. I got a chance to talk to him. It's been a long kind of journey for him. He said he suffered the shoulder injury he's been recovering from in 2018 when they played Winnipeg in the West semifinal, when he tried to tackle Andrew Harris. So it's been bugging him for a while. Finally got the surgery, missed 8 months of rehab there. And we'll see. It's this Riders defense needs to bounce back after last week. We expect them to be one of the top units in the CFL, and they got just exposed and just couldn't stop anything against the Bombers.
Yeah, and this group is, what are they, three short now of their starting group, with Moncrief and Marshall back, but Lacombo and Williams wouldn't be their projected starter. Although Jeremy Clark might be a healthy scratch because they like Deontay Williams that much. Like, yes, they must have really liked him to make that move, because Jeremy Clark never appeared on the injury report this week. So we assume that might just be performance related. So if that's the case, I don't even include those decisions as not having your number one guy. So it's Lacombe, Moncrief is back, and the defensive line with DeMarcus Christmas. Like, this is still a pretty good group when you look at who was going to be the starting lineup for the Rough Riders.
Yeah.
And I'll be interested to see how they match up. Like, when we flip it over to the Calgary Stampeders offense and Jake Mayer hasn't lit us on fire this season, over 300 yards against the Ottawa Red Blacks. But again, I know we got to talk about the BC Lions a little bit here. They shut them down last year. They, in the playoff game, they shut them down in week one, but they also just shut down Zach Collaros. And we saw what Collaros did last week. So, you know, buyer beware when you're thinking maybe, oh, the Rough Rider, like, I'm picking the Riders, but I'm starting to go, maybe I shouldn't pick the Riders against the Calgary Stampeders, because the one loss came against the BC Lions for the Stamps. And the BC Lions are clearly a better team right now than the Winnipeg Blue Bombers.
We thought the BC Lions might be the second best team in the CFL, and we might have underrated them at that point. That defense looks spectacular. The offense is clicking with Vernon Adams Jr. So, yeah, that's the fun thing about kind of these early season matchups, is we don't really know what these teams are until week five or six. So we're still trying to figure out who exactly is the cream of the crop in the West. And like you said, Calgary hasn't looked that way. But I mean, look at the Riders last week. What is this team? We don't know yet. So it's going to be exciting. But this defense, if Jake Mayer comes out and does what Zach Collaros just did, then I will start to get very concerned about that unit, because we thought the defense was going to have to really help this team out early as this offense figured it out.
Oh, absolutely. But the Calgary Stampeders are going through their own injuries. Dedrick Mills is in because Kadeem Carey is out. Now you have Reggie Bagleton's out for the Calgary Stampeders, so they're moving along some of their receiving core, although Dukes looks good early. Of course, Malik Henry's already shone as a receiver in the Canadian Football League, so they clearly still have some weapons with Calgary. But some changeover on the offensive line with the Stampeders, maybe that's where the Riders can get after it a little bit.
Yeah, that's what they'll need to do, right? Every team kind of dealing some injuries. I think that Bagleton injury is big for the Stamps passing attack, because outside of Dalton Schoen, he had the highest yardage by any receiver last week with 141 yards. So that's why this is going to be interesting, the early season matchup. And I'm wondering who this game is bigger for. Is it the Riders, as they kind of bounce back from last year, new offense, or is it the Calgary Stampeders? When I was on with Danny Austin on his podcast, Live from the 55, he asked me that, and I said it's bigger for Calgary this early because of you moving on from Bo. Jake Mayer needs to prove himself. The Riders, if they have a bad offensive day, you blame it on all the changes. You can put some of the blame on all of the changes they made. Calgary doesn't have that luxury. So what do you think, Jamie? Who's this bigger for early this season?
Well, I've said all week that I'm going to learn more about the Rough Riders this week than I did last week, because you can play up to the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. And now I believe it even more so after watching the BC Lions roll over the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. We're going, well, maybe that 18-point loss shouldn't have been as an optimistic indicator of where the Rough Riders are going as we thought last week after the game, when people are calling up saying, oh yeah, plan the parade route and they're going to win 14 games and here we go, they're going to be the second best team in the league. Nope, they're number three, maybe number four. Well, I have them at number four right now behind Winnipeg, BC, and Toronto, which is probably where they're at. And right below them is the Calgary Stampeders. So I think it's a toss-up on who this is bigger for in this one. Now, Danny Austin pointed out the schedule for the Stampeders after this one, and they're staring like 1-3, 1-4 in the face if they don't win this game. Thankfully for the Rough Riders, they play the Elks after the bye week. So, you know, even if they lose, that looks like, oh, they'll be 2-2 before they take on the BC Lions and the Stampeders once again. So, yeah, I think it's a toss-up. I think this is a big game for both teams. I'd probably side more so to Calgary, but not by much. As this is a great indicator game for both these teams on where they are, because they're middle of the pack, but they want to be on the upper edge of the middle of the pack rather than on the bottom edge, starting to think of, are we going to be in a fight for the playoffs later this season? What we do know is this is a huge 2 points for both these teams this early in the season in a divisional matchup.
It's June, and it feels like whoever wins this is going to finish third, and the other one's going to be battling for that maybe crossover spot.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, let's go to the offense. By the way, you'd think with a light on and doing a podcast, people wouldn't walk in on you on the studio, but, you know. Anyways, what do we got here? On the offensive side of the ball, Kendall Watson, he was someone that popped early for me at training camp. He's got a lot of speed, and he's getting a start this week. They're going to go four American receivers because of the injuries to Jawan Breskison and Kian Schaefer Baker. They're a little light on Canadian receivers. So that's one change, and we'll see if Peter Godbury is a game-time decision. They've also changed the tackles. Hawkins is back after that personal matter. Kelly is in because his two-game suspension is over. So there's, you know, three or four changes here for the Riders offense against the Calgary Stampeders. But I'm excited to see Kendall Watson. I want to start there. I think if I can find him on CFL Fantasy, if they've updated it yet, he might be a sneaky play this week.
He might be, and he's playing that slot back position, right? A little bit closer to the quarterback, could be used a lot here. And what's going to be really intriguing is how the Riders use the designated American this week on offense, or nationalized American, sorry, because only one starting Canadian wide receiver. This was a team we thought could start two or three at points. So we'll see what happens there. But like I said, Kendall Watson, guy has a lot of speed, popped during camp, and another hopefully depth piece this team has found. And when given your opportunity, never know, right? Tevin Jones popped last week. Maybe this is Kendall Watson's week to show what he can do.
Yeah, we'll see where it goes, because the designated nationalized American is Mario Alford. So if they use him, he's only replacing Emilis and Picton, right? Mm-hmm. So you go five Americans across the board at receiver. I don't know how much they'll run that. I'm way more intrigued on the defensive side on how they use Micah Johnson as the designated nationalized American, because they can rotate him in for Charbel DeBeer or Corte Moore 23 times, and they're probably going to do it. They're probably going to have to do it. So it's something I'm going to track. But on the offensive side, I doubt it's going to be as impactful. I was thinking it was going to be Jamal Morrow and Bertrand Hudon would be listed as the starter, but they didn't do that.
Yeah, that's what we thought. That's what I thought during this week of practice, because it was interesting watching Bertrand Hudon out there so much. Then no Canadian wide receivers but MLS. So, hey, we'll see. But speaking of changes, I'm sure you're going to talk about it, but Peter Godbury, game time decision, that could be a big one for them as well.
Well, that entire offensive line, they could have three changes along the offensive line with Ferland and Johnson if Peter Godbury's illness is bad enough to keep him out of the game against the Stampeders. And then Logan Bandy will fit in. And then I don't think they really have a backup. Well, I guess Zach Fry's on the practice roster, so you can emergency call him into the lineup for the Rough Riders. But Charbel DeBeer is listed as 99/57. So he might be the emergency offensive lineman in this game if they need it. But that would be a huge impact. Peter Godbury's graded out really well in the first 2 weeks for the Saskatchewan Rough Riders. But you have two new tackles. I'm surprised they made both decisions at the same time. I thought Council's been okay, but they really like Gerald Hawkins. He is back. He gets the left tackle spot. And I'm not really concerned about Colin Kelly. He's been a pretty good tackle in this league for a while and was one of the best offensive linemen in the XFL.
Yeah, exactly. It was interesting that they did make both these changes, because the offensive line hasn't been terrible at all. They've actually been pretty good thus far. I think this was a matter of this was the plan. This was what they wanted to run week one if everything went well, I guess Philip Blake was the plan, sorry. But this is what they wanted to run once they found out Philip Blake was injured. That's why they went out and signed Colin Kelly to the contract, I believe. Because, like you said, he's been in the league for a while. You know what you're getting from him. He's been a good force out there at tackle. And Gerald Hawkins, they really like him. He's a guy with some NFL experience. And who they, from day one of camp, were kind of grooming to be that left tackle, kind of getting him up to speed, learning the nuances of the defense. So this feels like this is what they want to run. This is what the plan always was. And now if you have to change the plan, you have a little bit more confidence in those other two guys, because last year, when they started moving parts along the offensive line, it fell apart quickly.
Oh, absolutely it did. When Dan Clark went down and, you know, they're playing around at tackle all over the place, it was ugly. It ended up in 77 sacks. But we know some of that was on Cody, too, with the offensive line. So we'll see how it goes. Now, the matchup against the Calgary Stampeders, I want to see a lot of Jamal Morrow here. That defensive line has lost a lot, and Jameer Thurman is gone as well, like one of the top linebackers they had. I would be trying to run the rock and a lot more diversified offense for the Saskatchewan Roughriders. They need to get this offensive line pushing and playing on their toes and dictating the play, because if it starts to go into we're just going to pass, that allows the defensive line to start teeing off on your offensive linemen. So I want to see Jamal Morrow get the ball. I'm probably saying 20 or so times on Saturday against the Stamps.
I don't think you need it that much. I'd like 15 from them. But, I mean, if you get them 20, 25 times, that means you're winning the football game. So, I mean, can't argue with that. This run game just hasn't been there. And that was something Craig Dickinson wanted. That was part of what Kelly Jeffrey said they wanted to do, was run the football. It's been non-existent. Jamal Morrow has 100 yards through two games, but 80 of that came in week one, only 20 last week. This run game needs to be better because, like you said, you can't just let defenses know you're going to pass. You have to keep them honest with the run game. Let's build some confidence here with Jamal Morrow and really, really try and like have the offensive line dominate the line of scrimmage. Don't let the defense dictate the game for you on offense, which is kind of what the Bombers offense and defense dictated what the Riders had to do last week with how good they were, but control the ball. So like I said, 15 or so carries I would like to see from Jamal Morrow this week.
Higher, give him the ball, run the rock, wear down that Calgary Stampeders defense, shut up that crowd in McMahon Stadium. Let's see it from the Rough Riders. Do you know who's going to support me on this, Britton? You know who it is?
Belton Johnson is going to want them to run the ball.
Right.
He wants them to run the ball 30 to 35 times a game.
Yeah, let's go. Run the rock. Dictate the play. Pound it. That's what we're going for. So that gives your offensive line a ton of confidence. So I'm looking for Jamal Morrow in this one. But it is the return to Calgary for Sean Bain Jr. That is a motivated young man to show up the team that he didn't really feel comfortable that had his back, and that's why he's a Saskatchewan Rough Rider.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what he told us, was that the team that signs you, you want to feel confidence from them that they believe in you, and he didn't feel that from Calgary. That's why he made the change. Saskatchewan pitched him on not only are you going to be a wide receiver, we'll get you the ball on flip plays, we'll get you the ball in a multitude of ways, and that's what he liked. So I'm excited to see Sean Bain Jr. It feels like he's so close to breaking through finally after those first 2 weeks. We kind of saw them connect on a deep ball in week two there. So it feels like Calgary might be the game where Sean Bain Jr. has that performance like we saw from Sam Emelis last week. I'm not going to say he's going to score 3 touchdowns. That doesn't happen a lot. But he could very well be on his way to a big game.
Yeah, he wants a big game against the Calgary Stampeders defense. There's no doubt about it. So I think I'm playing him this week in CFL Fantasy. Are you too?
I'm sticking with Sam Emelis. You know, just got a Frankie Hickson was my constant.
I don't know. After 3 touchdowns, you'd have to think that's going to come back down to earth, that he's not going to carry that over. But, okay, we'll see. I got Sean Bain Jr. And the one thing I like about what how is how they're using Sean Bain Jr. He's lining out outside. He's lined up at slot. He's coming on jet sweeps. They're utilizing all the tools he brings, and that's what I like to see about Kelly Jeffrey's offense, is it is really adaptable to the people he has rather than trying to force players to do things that aren't really their strengths.
Yeah, exactly. Through the first 2 weeks, I don't think we've had complaints about Kelly Jeffrey play calling. We've had complaints about coaching decisions at times, sure, to go for field goals instead of go for it. But the offense has looked really smooth. And like you said, he's using players in ways that they want to be used and kind of accentuates their strengths a little bit more. And so we'll see what he has planned this week, because no issues with Kelly Jeffrey so far. It looks like he has been calling the game the right way in certain moments.
Other quick note, just Brett Lawther. Are you concerned yet? Another missed kick last week?
No, not quite, but I think you asked me last week. I was at 2% concern. I think I'm up to 7 or 8% now, because if after the bye week he keeps missing, at that point you can't really blame a new holder. They should have it figured out. So then you maybe have to be like, well, something might be awry here.
And Trevor Harris is going to start, right? Where there's no question this week about Trevor Harris.
Do you want to put a lunch bet on this one?
Yeah, I'll put a lunch bet that he starts.
No, he's going to play. I want the same odds as last week.
And yes, I did get Britton lunch already this week because he said Trevor Harris was going to start. I didn't think so. I was incorrect on that. But I'm tired of the gamesmanship, to be quite honest, on the quarterback thing. Like, look what Hamilton did this week. There's no gamesmanship. It was just like, no, Matthew Schultz is the quarterback. That's it, period. Starting the week. No questions asked. It's not a distraction. The media is not asking questions. It's Matthew Schultz. I would rather that. Because when Craig Dickinson says, oh, yeah, I knew he was going to play all week, I'm like, why are you playing games? Because you know what the game did? You know what all those games did? You still lost by 18 points. So,
yeah.
You're not going to trick Mike O'Shea and the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. Okay. Let's go around the Canadian Football League, because I know you really want to talk about that BC game and who the BC Lions are and the questions about Winnipeg. And this has thrown the Canadian Football League in disarray. I checked the score app this morning, the standings. They still had Winnipeg as first place at 2-1 with BC at second at 3-0. Like, even stats pages can't compute that the Winnipeg Blue Bombers lost to the BC Lions. But not only lost, the BC Lions dominated them from start to finish. The defensive line owned the Winnipeg offensive line, which has been the best offensive line for PFF, Pro Football Focus, over the first 2 weeks. So much for that. And thank goodness, it's about time, because we can stop the Stanley Bryant as the top offensive lineman in the league. He hasn't been for 2 years. He keeps getting voted as the top offensive lineman in the league because it is the left tackle of a good team gets the most outstanding offensive lineman. He hasn't been that. He was exposed by Matthew Betts and David Menard in that game.
Yeah, exactly. The last night was the first night where it finally looked like the Winnipeg Blue Bombers looked old. The young, energetic BC Lions team completely dominated the line of scrimmage, and it wasn't close from the get-go. Only 6 points the entire game from Winnipeg. There is cause for concern there. I know some Winnipeg fans might not view it as cause for concern. It's just one loss. But they got completely crushed on both sides of the football. They had zero answers. And Father Time is undefeated. Eventually, it sneaks up on everyone. And the Bombers' time might be ticking. Like you said, this throws the entire CFL into disarray. But that makes the CFL better, doesn't it? With the fact that we're not just maybe putting the Winnipeg Blue Bombers in the Grey Cup again. It makes the league more exciting. You don't know what's going to happen. And now we'll see. We'll see if this is just the fact that the BC Lions might now be far and away the best team in the league, Or if there's some cracks finally starting to show in the armor of Winnipeg and some other teams might be able to win the season against them.
Well, it's the BC Lions are number one on the power rankings next week. That's no ifs, ands, buts about it. They are the best team now in the Canadian Football League. Don't call it over for Winnipeg yet. They've had some bad games over the course. They have a letdown. We'll see how they respond. I imagine Mike O'Shea will have them ready to go. And they'll still be one of the best, but you're bang on. Thankfully, it looks like there's going to be a little bit more parity in the race in the West Division, or maybe not. Maybe it's just BC's going to run away with it, but at least it's a different team. When it's just, okay, Winnipeg 2021, Winnipeg 2022, they weren't the best team in 2019. They were the strongest team at the end of the season, but it just felt like, oh, here we go again. And we'll see how they come out of this, how they react. This will be maybe the most adversity they've faced since the fourth quarter of the Grey Cup game in 2022 overall for the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. But, man, if Vernon Adams Jr. can continue to not make mistakes at the quarterback and that defense, the BC Lions are a beast. And that's why I don't know about the Calgary Stampeders anymore, because they lost to BC in week one. And I'm starting to go, okay. Then they go out to Ottawa and win, and they'll go for over 300 yards. I'm a lot more scared of the Calgary Stampeders because of what BC did. And the Riders' 18-point loss goes, okay, did they lose by 18 to a mediocre, or I guess an above-average team rather than a great dominant team? You probably have to go with the former on that one.
Yeah, exactly. Like you said, this is a big measuring stick game for both of these teams, where exactly they rank compared to some of the other teams in the CFL. And I mean, I really hope Vernon Adams Jr. keeps this up. I've been a Vernon Adams Jr. fan for what he's done. I think he's one of the more exciting quarterbacks in the CFL when he's on. We just haven't seen the consistency. If he finds that consistency, that will work great for the league, because on the show this week, I talked about being able to build around Chad Kelly as the next superstar in this league. Vernon Adams Jr. is the same sort of deal, where if you could build around him as the next superstar in the league, that puts the CFL in a better spot overall, that you have some younger quarterbacks that you can market and put out there, which the CFL needs to do a better job of getting the players out there, but you can start to do it with a couple of these guys.
And Chad Kelly, check out his stats at cfl.ca. Oh, wait, never mind. You can't check out his stats.
It's not a failure, Jamie. Randy Ambrose, okay. It's not a failure.
See, that's gaslighting. Like, that is the commissioner trying to gaslight the fans, going, oh, no, this is going to be great. And we tried to do that. We're doing this great new thing. You told the fans before the season, they sent out a release about the stats and how it's going to be revolutionary and how it's going to be exciting and can't wait to show this thing off. It's week three and it's not ready. You got through the preseason. It wasn't ready. This has been, where are you at? June 23rd. We're a month after games started in the preseason. It's beyond a month. And to not have live stats updating for a younger fan who's engaged and who's gambling and all that other stuff, it's a failure. It is an abject failure. The CFL should be embarrassed about it. And to have the commissioner float it out there that, nah, it's no big deal. It's not a failure. This is just a thing that you have to go through. Hey, the product might be great. It probably will be great. It'll probably be phenomenal. But the launch of it has been a failure. Don't lie to your fans. Don't lie to them to their face, because you see the reaction on social media. They're laughing at him. They're laughing at Randy Ambrosi. We're all laughing at that quote that it's not a failure. Like, you're living in denial. Mm-hmm. And it's still a bad look for the league on this stats thing at the start of the year. And who knows? I'm hearing the historical stats on the website might not be ready until like August or September or something like that. So
that's brutal.
We might get the live like 2023 stats, but the historical stuff might not be ready for a while.
It's just so bad. I just don't understand how you don't have this ready to roll out, but not only don't you have it ready to roll out, you got rid of the old system, that you don't just use the old system until the new one is ready, because it was working fine. Like, we were getting live stats. It was working well enough. I don't understand why they got rid of that. Like I said, did someone hit a wrong button and get rid of all the historical stats on CFL.ca? Because it makes no sense. Now, in my job, like, I rely on those historical stats for a lot of the articles I write about guys to give context of what they've done in the league. And fans like to see what Bo has done before, what Trevor Harris has done before. When was the last time a quarterback threw for 400 yards for the Saskatchewan Roughriders? You can't even look at previous season games. All they have is the Grey Cup game from previous seasons. It is mind-blowing that I can't use the CFL official website to find these game-by-game stats. You have to Google, go to a different website, hope that that website is correct, and kind of go off that, which is not a place people watching a professional league should be in. Like I told Ian Hamilton, my broomball league has live stats and stats up right away.
I was following along while you're at provincial, or was it nationals? I was like almost minute by minute broomball stats to see if Britton Gray got another holding penalty.
And only one, just one holding penalty, but it is just a poor look on a professional league. And we've said it before, the CFL needs to quit giving ammunition to its haters, and it does it every year.
Yes, it does. And I know the team that's behind the scenes, they're frustrated, that they want it to succeed. They want it to look good, and it just hasn't been there. They continue, like, this is an everyday battle right now at CFL headquarters on trying to get this right, which is terrible. And I'd like to know, was it genius sports? And are there repercussions? Will they still get the piece of the pie they're owed for CFL Ventures? I would think you'd have to look at them and go, we want our money back for this, or at least part of it, because it has been an awful look for the league. But other CFL stuff, as I mentioned earlier, no Bo Levi Mitchell. It's Matthew Schultz against the Montreal Alouettes. That game is tonight. I'm picking Hamilton with Matthew Schultz. And I know people are going to be like, oh, you hate Cody Fajardo. You disrespect to Cody. I just didn't think they were that impressive against Ottawa. And Hamilton's got something to prove after losing their first two games of the season. And I do like Matthew Schultz. I like his athletic ability. If the offensive line isn't that great, he can extend a play.
Yeah, Matthew Schultz is kind of underrated as a quarterback in this league. He was maybe kind of, when the Riders were searching for a quarterback, his name was appearing as someone maybe they take a flyer on and finally give him that opportunity. I think Hamilton's overall roster is better. They have something to prove. And with Montreal, I need to see you do it against a team that's not Ottawa without Jeremiah Mazzoli. That's the thing. I hope Cody Fajardo has a ton of success there, because this league needs good quarterbacks, and we've seen how exciting he can be back in 2019 with his ability to run and make plays. I just need to see it more. We've seen kind of, not Hamilton do it, but less changes there. That, like, Tim White has done it before. There's a lot of veterans on that team, and I just like Hamilton a little better this week.
Yeah, we'll see. If they get William Standback rolling, yes. It could be a long day for the Hamilton Tiger Cats defense. But I'm excited to see this one. The other game on Sunday, Toronto at Edmonton. Is anybody picking the Elks to end this streak at home against Toronto? Like, Chad Kelly looked good. The Elks got shut out. Now, the Elks got shut out again by a really, really good BC team, as we're finding out.
I am.
So
I picked the Elks. I did it.
Why?
I just feel like this is I just have a feeling this is finally the game the Elks win at home.
Are you willing to put a lunch on it? You want to put a lunch on this?
No, you're not going to convince me this week. You're not going to convince me this week. But in my CFL picks, I do have the Elks winning this week. It just feels like it. I think Chris Jones will have a good game plan, and I think we're going to maybe see Taylor Cornelius from last season, where they let him run a little bit more this week. Because Chris Jones is sick and tired of those questions about losing at home. He wants them finished.
Britton. Britton. Come on, man. Like,
be brave, Jamie. It's,
I know Toronto's on the road. I know Chad Kelly's a rookie quarter, but it's not just the offense. It's not like AJ Ouellette's a good play. Like, they have a lot of talent. That Argonauts defense, the talent they have across the board, like Forlanora Malade, who came over from Calgary, is one of the best defensive ends in the league. They have one of the best linebacking cores in the league. They have one of the best secondaries in the league. I can't believe Toronto's actually keeping it under the salary cap this year, but I think they're saving some money with Chad Kelly at quarterback rather than McLeod Bethel Thompson. So they are going to beat the Edmonton Elks. They are going to beat the Edmonton Elks.
Hey, it's already off to a weird start to this week. We all thought Winnipeg might beat the BC Lions.
No. BC's a good team.
I'm just saying.
BC's a good team. Edmonton is not a good football team.
Maybe Edmonton just
now
needs some positive vibes thrown their way. Here you go, Edmonton. Allow me to toss some positivity your way this week.
Toronto's favored by 6.5. They're going to win by more.
So
than
were
that.
The
they're
Winnipeg by... Blue Bombers. They were fair. It's all coming.
That was
together.
A weird line, though. That was a weird line.
That was a tough line.
Again, like BC was a really good team, especially after the game against Saskatchewan when the Riders held in against Winnipeg. It was interesting on that line. So there's the week. Speaking of lines, with our partners at PlayNow.com, as we're in the PlayNow.com studio. Let's look at some of this for the Riders and the Stampeders. The Stampeders, 3.5-point favorites. We're both picking the Riders, right?
Yeah.
To win?
Yeah. Even if they lose, it will be like a 1 or 2 points. It is going to be a really close game, I feel.
Yeah. And the over-under on the score is 45.5. I always kind of look at it and go, okay, they're looking at like a 24-21 type game then. In favor of the Calgary Stampeders, and it's probably pretty close to what it's going to be. But I would lean over. I'm not thrilled with either of these defenses, and there's a lot of offensive firepower on both these teams.
I think both these teams want to prove where their offense is at right now. Trevor Harris and all the changes, and Jake Mayer proving that he can be not just a good franchise quarterback, but a great one in the CFL. So I think both offenses want to come out and put up a lot of points this week.
Okay, let's go to the individual over and unders going in. You looked at the Tevin Jones 49.5 line, and you're salivating, Britton, I think.
He was used a lot last week. He was thrown to a lot. He clearly has the trust of Trevor Harris already. And he goes into that Darrell Walker spot, which, as we saw through preseason and the first game, that spot is being targeted. That is a focal point of the offense. I think it continues this week. Tevin Jones, I think, will have another big game, probably 70 to 80 yards is where my prediction would be for him again.
See, the one I'm looking at is Sean Bain Jr. He's got the same one, 49.5, up against his former team, the Calgary Stampeders. I think they got a game plan to get Sean Bain Jr. the ball. He wants the ball. He's going to be motivated. I would favor the over on Sean Bain Jr. against the Calgary Stampeders, his former team, when playing that game. So if you're going over with Tevin and I'm going over with Sean Bain, what do you think of Trevor Harris at 254.5 after a 400-yard passing game against the Winnipeg Blue Bombers?
I think with our two receivers alone, we have them already up near 150, 160 yards. So I like the over. But like I said, I've liked the over on Trevor Harris all year so far. I just feel like with what we've seen from him and the fact that the run game hasn't been going anywhere for the Riders, I do like the over again for Trevor Harris because, once again, this offense wants to get the passing game going again, I feel.
Yeah, I'm totally avoiding Jamal Morrow.
Like, yeah.
Until I get a better feel for Jamal Morrow in this run game, I'm avoiding it. It's at 49.5, or 59.5, I mean. And it's just like, okay. I think it should be over. Like, I think they should give him the ball a lot. But this run game has been a little lackluster outside of one quarter of football in game one against Edmonton.
Yeah, but I mean, all you really need is one quarter. If you can hand the ball off for eight times and the guy gets 50-some yards, hey, you're right there, which is what happened week one to me when I was like, Jamal Morrow, give me the under because Frankie Hickson's there, and lo and behold, he hit it. So the run game right now with Saskatchewan's too volatile for me, so I'm staying away from it right now.
And of course, with PlayNow.com, we got a Green Zone special. You can go to PlayNow.com/Green Zone, and it's a $50 sports free bet right there with a $10 deposit. And you can, maybe use that money to make some money at PlayNow.com/Green Zone. Check it out. The offer is good into July, so better get on it with some free sports bets with us in the Green Zone and PlayNow.com. And of course, you got to be 19+. And they do have that Game Sense button. As always, you can set budgets for yourself and things like that at playnow.com. So there you go. That's what we're looking. We're both taking the Riders. What score? What do you got? If you're doing bold predictions this week, what would your score be?
My score is, I believe, 33-28 Riders.
Yeah, I'm thinking like 30-22. I think they'll win by like a touchdown. I really do. I think the Rough Riders will go into Calgary. There'll be a lot of green there at the worst stadium in the Canadian Football League, McMahon Stadium. And I think we'll be impressed on the Green Zone postgame show on Saturday night. But as always, the Green Zone pregame show, 3:00 Saturday before the 5:00 kickoff on TSN. Your all or nothing this week is on Sean Bain and his return to Calgary.
Yeah, and just kind of the path he's had. His dad was one of the best high school football players ever seen in Sarasota, Florida. He was, I think, voted number 4 as the greatest all time there. And we know Florida's a football hotbed. So, but kind of the tragedy of it, his father unfortunately passed away. But he still brings him to every game because he has his ashes in a football urn that he's brought along with him. So a great story on a great young player and someone who Trevor Harris has called a breakout candidate of the year.
I've also called him that, Britton, back when they signed him from the Calgary Stampeders. So we'll look forward to that. All or nothing, of course. We'll go inside the green and white on the Green Zone pregame show. I can't wait to see what Belton's got for us on the tailgating tips and who's going to eat. Did you get any of the meatball sliders last week?
I was so shocked you guys saved me some. I was surprised to walk in there and there be some. They were delicious. And like you said, every week it's such excitement more about what Belton's bringing in than sometimes the football game itself.
Well, I'll tell you what, Britton, that had nothing to do with myself and Daryl Davis. That all had to do with technical producer Chance, because we just laid the platter down when we went to the game and went, hey, have at it. I'll say, I think Daryl actually might have said, don't save any for Britton, but it was Chance who decided to make sure you had some of that stuff. So you can credit him a little later on when you see him. But also we have Marshall Hamilton as our Rider alumni. We talked to Derek Wigan of the Calgary Stampeders for Behind Enemy Lines. So look forward to that with our bold predictions on the Green Zone pregame show, 3:00 on Saturday before the 5:00 kickoff. But that's it for us here on The Blitz, the podcast with the Green Zone. I'm Jamie Nye. He's Britton Gray. We'll be back again. What are we, 2 weeks? We're not doing one next week because it's a bye week. I'm camping, so you can do one by yourself.
We'll see. I might also decide, you know, take the week off, go to the beach if the weather's nice, work on my tan a little bit more before I head out to Vegas in a couple weekends. So gotta get the base tan going, because it is going to be hot in Las Vegas.
Yeah, I was like, I don't know how the Wi-Fi is at Echo to do one of this next week. But, of course, it's a bye week next week. And then what do we got after that? It's July 6th at home against the Edmonton Elks. Can we do guaranteed win night on July 6th?
We'll see. We'll see. I'll ask the players. Are you guaranteeing a win?
I'll check in. Maybe I'll guarantee a win on the Blitz going into that game. in a couple of weeks. Enjoy the Riders and the Stamps. Join us on the pre- and post-game show in the Green Zone this weekend. Thanks for tuning in.